Let us pray. Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for this opportunity we have, blessed opportunity to be in your presence and to be in church. Heal us, Lord. Save us. Teach us, instruct us. Let your word be like light unto us, Lord. Thank you for your great blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Take your seats. Hallelujah. Turn your Bibles to John chapter 1. And we started sharing on the, what do we call our message? Prayer promises. Prayer promises. Okay. Prayer promises of Jesus, isn't it? Are you happy with promises? How many of you like promises? How many of you like it when you are promised? I think ladies like it when they are promised, isn't it? When he says he will marry you, isn't it? Yeah. It's your greatest promise of life. But I'm showing you greater promises than that guy who promised you that he would give you his name. Yeah, but I think it's one of the great promises for the young ladies that all your life, even your graduation is not as exciting as when that young boy who is jobless says that. I mean, jobless only because he's a student. You know, he will get a mega job. Yeah. When he tells you that, he would. When I told my wife I'm married here, I was jobless. I didn't have a job, yeah. Because I was a student. Yeah, I was a student. My father was giving me money. And I was telling girls that I'll marry them. What a shock. Yeah, but she had faith and I had faith. And we are there today. Your story shall change.
Amen.
You also get a mega job.
Amen.
Baby, I'm talking about promises. I'm talking about promises. And I'm saying that a promise, we like promises because it's very nice when you are promised something, isn't it? You shall be promised something.
Amen.
And the promiser shall deliver.
Amen.
You will never be disappointed.
Amen.
Your life shall never be a disappointment.
Amen.
Are you receiving that blessing?
Amen.
I said, your life shall never be a disappointment.
Amen.
Never expect disappointment.
Amen.
Don't expect it.
Amen.
Because it is not coming your way.
Amen.
It has been redirected from your path.
Amen.
Any disappointment that was headed in your direction, I change its direction today.
Amen.
It is moving away from you.
Amen.
You will not be disappointed.
Amen.
Why? Am I just talking? I'm talking because the scripture says that the expectation of the righteous shall not be cut off. Do you understand that? The expectation. When you are promised, you expect the promise to be fulfilled, isn't it? For whoever has said, I will do this, you expect the person to do what they said. At least they should do what they said they will do. I mean, you said you marry me, at least marry me. I'm not saying buy me a car or anything. You just said you will marry me. Just marry me. Do you understand? Do you understand? Just do what you said you will do. You said you'll buy me KFC.
Yay!
Just bring the KFC. Just bring the KFC. Just bring the KFC. Just give me the KFC. Just give me some hot wings. Just do what you said. It's an expectation. When there's a promise, the person who has been promised begins to expect what they said they will do. Have you been promised before?
Yes.
Has someone told you they will do something before?
Yes.
They put you in a state of expectation. Everything that God has promised you, you will find it. and it shall happen in your life. Is it? The promises of God will happen practically in your life. Amen. Practically. You will experience them practically. Amen. You will see yourself living the word of God. You know, one day, I went somewhere and I went out of that place and I didn't go back there for 4 years. So when I went back to the place that I had not been for 4 years, I met somebody that I met the first time I went there. Does it make sense to you? Okay. So when I went there, I saw this person and I saw that this person was staring at me because I was talking to someone else. And then this other person, whom I had not seen since I first visited 4 years ago, was staring. So I turned. See, when someone is staring at you, the best thing to turn and just and say hello. You just say hi. Hi. So I turned to say hello. And she said hello back. And then she asked, "Is this Richard?" I said, "It is." I said, "It is." And I also said, "Are you yourself?" "Happy to see you again." And then she said, "Wow, this is the word made flesh." She pointed at me and said, "I am the word made flesh." I didn't ask her why, because I didn't want to know why. I didn't ask her why she was saying what, but she's like, it's like she can see a change, a transformation. And the only explanation she can give to the transformation is like a verse she has read or verses she had read. And now she can see the verses living in a human being. That shall be your story. Somebody will see you, and when they see you, you shall be an explanation of what the Bible says. When the Bible says your expectation. When the Bible says that your expectation shall not be cut off. You see, you have to start announcing your expectations. You have to start announcing your expectations. That this is what the Bible says about me. This is what God says about you. And so when we see you, we're in 2017. When we see you in 2019, when we see you in 2020, so when we see you in 2021, especially 2021, if I like start counting from now, 2021, when we see you, you will see that your expectation has not been cut off. Your expectation has not been cut off. And your expectation is not based on what some boy has said. No. It's not based on what some girl has said. Your expectation is based on what the Bible says. What the Bible has said about you. What the Bible has said about you. We shall see you and we'll say that this is the word made flesh. Your expectation shall never be cut off. What you are expecting shall be delivered.
Amen.
I said, what you're expecting shall be delivered.
Amen.
It shall happen practically. Practically. You'll be happy again.
Amen.
Those of you who have experienced some disappointment, you'll be happy again.
Amen.
You will be happy again.
Amen.
You will be happy again.
Amen.
You will never die a depressed person.
Amen.
You will be happy.
Amen.
You'll be happy. God is about to offload reasons for you to dance.
Amen.
Reasons for you to rejoice.
Amen.
Reasons for you to be happy.
Amen.
It shall be offloaded into your life.
Amen.
Don't worry. Don't worry. He doesn't need you to do it.
Amen.
It shall be effortless.
Amen.
It shall be effortless.
Amen.
You are the ones that he will give it to you. He will bring you to the front of the church to come and tell the church that it has happened.
Amen.
What I least expected.
Amen.
What I thought was impossible. Because he's a God of possibilities.
Amen.
I think God likes it when it is impossible. He likes it. He likes it. Because whenever, you see, when all options are exhausted, the only thing left now is God. Then you start looking up to God. You start looking up to God. When you've tried this, that, everything hasn't worked, you start looking up to him. That is when you start saying that it's by the grace of God. You shall say it is by the grace of God. He will do it for you. He will do it for you. It shall be made possible. You watch him. You watch him. Just relax and watch him. I told you, it's your season of what? Effortlessness. You won't try and it will happen. You won't try and it will happen. You haven't tried and you say it's happening. It's happening. Effortless. Effortlessly. It shall be, it is your testimony. Amen. It is your story. Amen. It shall characterize your life.
Amen.
Effortlessness. Amen. Things that people are sweating for, you are receiving it.
Amen.
The scripture says that everything that you have, you received it. It is received. When you have something, it is received. It means that it is given to you. And it is given to you by God. It's given to you by God. God will give it to you.
Amen.
You shall become recipients of good things from God. Good thing. You'll be collecting things.
Amen.
You'll be collecting things. Good things will be delivered to you.
Amen.
So sit down and let's talk about promises. Prayer promises. This week, expect good things.
Amen.
Yes, expect it.
Amen.
Everything that you've been waiting for a long time, expect it this week.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
You see, there are some of you here, your testimony, are you listening to what I'm saying? Your testimony shall be this way. I didn't think it was possible. I had given up. I had resigned. I thought it wasn't going to be. But there I am. God has opened the door. God has done it. Some of you here, that will be your testimony. That shall be your testimony. That which you have given up on, God is about to resurrect it. He will do it for you. It will be free. He won't charge you. He will do it freely.
Amen.
Free. Free. It will be done. Are you receiving it? It will be done. It will be done. He'll do it for you like that. He'll put your heart and your mind at rest. You are greater than you see yourself now. Hey! You people are powerful people. Blessed people. Anointed people. You are greater than you appear now. You are greater. You are far greater than you look at now. Yeah. Far greater. Far anointed. Sit down. Prayer promises. There are promises. Promises. Have you seen how when you order something on Amazon and you do next day delivery? Prime, Amazon Prime. Then you keep looking outside. Is it coming? The other day I ordered something and I was traveling. I was traveling the following day and I needed it before I leave. And the order, everything says that it will be delivered by 9 p.m. It will come. And I said, so I had an expectation. Because they had promised that they would deliver by 9 p.m. So there I was. 6 p.m., no delivery. 7 p.m., no delivery. 8 p.m., no delivery. So now I started looking out of the window. From 8 o'clock, I looked at 10 past 8. There was no van. 8:15, no van. 8:20, no van. 8:25, the van hasn't appeared. 8:30, nothing. But do you know what happened at 8:30? After 8:30, I forgot that I was expecting something. Then 8:45, I saw a van outside. And I had forgotten. So I started shouting in the house. Has anyone ordered anything? There's a van outside the house. Who is he? What does he expect? What does he want? And by this time, 8:45 p.m., nobody will answer the door. I said, I'm the man of the house. So I went and I opened the door. When I opened the door, he had three parcels. And he put it in my hand. He said, can you mention your name? I said, Mr. Airy. Mr. Airy. He said, yes, it's for you. Then I looked at it and I saw the Amazon Prime tape on it. I said, oh, it's mine. It shall be yours. Every good thing shall be yours. It was delivered at 8:45. 8:45, it came. My expectation was not cut off. Your expectation shall never be cut off. Never be cut off. Never be cut off. Never be cut off. The happiness you're expecting, you shall have it. You will also be happy.
Amen.
You will also be happy.
Amen.
You'll be happy. You're not going to live some sad life.
No. No.
That curse is overturned today.
Amen.
So anyway, in John chapter 16, in John chapter 16, are you there? Yes. Are you in John? Do you have chapter 16? Verse 23 says that, and in that day you shall ask me nothing. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you. This is a promise. Can you see? And he said, anything that you ask in my name, in my name, in my, the name of Jesus is a very special name. It's a very, very special name. Don't devalue the name of Jesus in your life. Don't use it as a swear word. Don't use it as an exclamation mark. Don't use it to emphasize your seriousness. Don't joke with it. Don't let it become some common term that just comes out of your mouth. Because it's a very serious name that changes lives. It changes your life from eternal condemnation and damnation to eternal life. That you are blessed and you are, it gives you salvation. It brings salvation. The name of Jesus brings salvation. So it's not a name to be joked with. So now he's teaching his disciples and saying that in that day, you shall ask nothing. Very, verily I say unto you, you shall ask me nothing. Very, verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father, that is when he's left and he's gone. He said, now, at that time, you won't ask me because you won't see me, but you'll be talking to the Father. And when you talk to him, when you ask him, and you mention my name, when you mention my name, that you know me, you know about me, he will give it to you. He will give it to you. He will give it to you. When you use my name, there are names here on earth that when you use, you get things. Even me, people use my name. People use my name. People say, Bishop said. Bishop said. Bishop said. And it changes things for them. People drop my name all the time. Sometimes things I don't know about. Forever, my name has been used. That I said. And I'll just ask, when did I say that? I never said that. But Jesus is teaching that, you know, when you tell the Father, you tell the Father that, you know, I believe in your son that you gave. believe in him. That anything you ask shall be given. Then he says in verse 24, hitherto you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. Your joy shall be full.
Amen.
You know, joy. Imagine a jar of jam that's not full, that you've been eating. I don't know how you take your jam. Some people, after they've taken the jam, you don't want to use the jam again. But there's an art. There's an art. As you take it, you see that. So you just have to scrape the jam off. Yes. You see the jam jar is half full. Even though it contains jam, but it's not full. The scripture is saying that when you ask in the name of Jesus, your joy will be full. Your joy will be full. It's like there will be nothing that you want that you don't have. There will be nothing that you want to be happy. You rather be marking and taking your expectations and your prayers. And you see that everything that you want, you take this one, God has done it. Take this one, God has done it. Take this one, God has done it. You take, God shall do everything for you.
Amen.
That your joy will be full. Your joy will be full. Have you been there? Have you been there where someone asked you, what do you want for your birthday? And you thought, and there was nothing that you wanted. If you've never been there, you shall come there.
Amen.
You will practically be there.
Wow.
My friend in the United States called me. This is about 4 or 5 years ago. And he asked me. He said, Charlie, Ricardo, your birthday, what should I get for you?
Wow.
And I remember I was on the phone. I said, I don't know. I don't want anything. I don't need anything. I don't know what I want. And he said, oh, Charlie, make you try. It's like, think a bit. And I was on the phone. I didn't need anything.
Wow.
And we're seriously talking. It's like, Charlie, you sure say you know they want this? You mentioned this. You sure say you know they want this? I said, no. You sure say you know they like this? I said, no. You sure say if I get you this one, you don't go like? I said, no, I know they like. I know they like anything. He said, ah. Then at the point, he said to me, he said, Charlie, Ricardo, God has blessed you. Then I said, oh, why? He said, today I'm asking you. Because we've been together. We've been together. It's been hot. It's been cool. Then it gets hot. Then it's cool. Then it gets very hot for a long time. Then it gets cool. He said, Charlie, it be you that today I'm asking you what you they want for your birthday. And you don't need anything. He said, God, 27 occurred to me that it is true. Because it's not like I was pretending. It's not one of those ones that you'll be asked, are you sure? After church, when Edwina offers me a drink and said, no, I'm okay. Then she said, are you sure? I mean, she's so sweet. You see her. She just say, are you sure? Are you sure? It's like, look, I have drinks. It's like, if you don't like what I have something else. It's like, are you sure? Sunday, she'll be saying, are you sure? I said, I am sure. I don't want to drink. I am sure. When I want, I will tell you. I am sure. It's not one of those that you want, but you're acting like you don't want. No, it's not one of those ones. This one, because I can tell him anything that I want. There's nothing that I want that I can tell him. He's like a brother to me. There's nothing that I want that I can tell him. But there I was. I didn't need anything. You shall come to that place.
Amen.
You shall come there. It's a blessing. Your joy shall be full. May God make your joy full.
Amen.
The last time somebody asked me that, he said, I want to pray for you. What should I pray for? When I gave them the topic, they looked at me. I don't know whether it was disappointment or it's like, hey, you know the look that's like, hey. You know a man. the expression was like, it's like, only you. It's almost like, why did I even ask? I knew this is what you say. But I don't need cashew nuts. I don't need almonds. What I needed, it's only God who can give it. Where I've reached what I need, it's only God who can. It's God. It's God who can come with it. So I was like, this is what you can ask God for. Ask God for this. He was like, you know a man. He's a spirit. Your desires shall become spiritual things. Because you see, all these things that you want, God will just, he'll just throw it into your life. Yeah. See that you just have them. You shall have no need.
Amen.
That your joy may be full. What does verse 25 say? These things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs, but then by the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. Then verse 26. At that day you shall ask in my name. And I say unto you, that I will pray the Father for you. For the Father himself loveth you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came out from God. Give me verse 26 again. He said, and that day you shall ask in my name. This is the day when we will use the name of Jesus. So it's the leading promise, it's the leading prayer promise to use the name of Jesus. Use his name. Don't stop using it when you hit your foot against a chair in your house. Instead of saying, ouch, they say, Jesus. No, the appropriate expression is ouch. Say ouch and move on. When you see it swelling, you see, it looks as though there's a problem. Then you lay hands and say, Father, in the name of Jesus. That's what you do. But not that, you are driving and there's someone else. You say, Jesus. Don't use the name of Jesus that way. Use it for real things. Real things. You'll see real results.
Amen.
Receive testimonies.
Amen.
Receive answers to your prayers.
Amen.
Use the name of Jesus. You see real things. So anyway, so last 2 weeks, what were some of the promises that we went through? Number one was what? God has promised to answer prayers to those who use the name of Jesus. Second one was what? Those who abide in him. Are you going to abide in him?
Yes.
How do you practically abide in him? By abiding in his church. Can you cut your head off and put it on the side? So when you disengage yourself or dislocate yourself from the body of Christ, which is the church is the body of Christ. Understand it. understand it. Those of you who are not, you are not very deep, and you bring up childish arguments that going to church doesn't mean that you're a Christian. Going to church means 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 you're a Christian. It means you are a member of the body of Christ. Can you tell your nose, Ruby, that you have this... that this nose... How will you call this nose? What name will you give to it? Is it called a nose? So, what's the name of this? If we... Where are my screwdrivers?
Wow.
Take it off. Can you see it? What is this? This is Ruby's nose. It belongs to her. It is part of her body. It is part of her. You can't separate. The nose can't go. If I take her nose off, can you see it?
Yes.
Like face off. So nose off. Can you see nose off?
Yes.
The nose is of no use. It's of no, do you want it? Should I give it to you?
No.
Because you have your nose. You have your nose. You wouldn't want Ruby's nose. It fits Ruby's face.
Wow.
I brought her nose back. Hey. So when you separate yourself with those childish debates, I don't have to be in the church to be. You have to be in the church to be. You have to be. You have to be. You have to be in a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching, Bible... whatever type of church to be a Christian, you have to be. The scripture says in the book of the book of Hebrews, it says that forsaking not the assembling of ourselves together, forsaking not the assembling of ourselves together. You don't forsake the this is an assembly. You're in an assembly, you are part of an assembly. So you find the assembly that you are in. And then you stay there. You don't wake up. Can you imagine if tomorrow morning you wake up and your nose says that I'm leaving? Will you like it? You see, sometimes in the church, thank you, in the church, you don't even realize, but you are like a leg in the church. You're like the ear in the church. You're like eyes. You're like nose. You're like this. So when you remove yourself, when you remove yourself, that is why we come after you. Because we are a body. We are a body. And that is when you also make yourself useless. If I take Cliff's ear off, Cliff takes his ear off, what is he going to do with it? Which restaurant will buy his ear? The restaurants buy beef. They don't buy ears, they buy beef. You can't just separate yourself. I separate myself from my calling, from the church. I said, where would I go? Yesterday I was walking through airports. I saw immigration officers. What do you call these people? The people at the counter, air hostesses, air stewards, ground stewards. I realized I don't belong to this world. I was looking, they look very busy and serious. I said, I don't belong here. There's nothing for me to do. There's nothing for me to do for them. They should just give me my boarding pass so I can sit down and go. There's nothing. I don't belong there. So if I take myself out of the church, I go to an airport, I don't belong there. I go to a military base, they'll sack me. So don't separate yourself from the church. Abide. Abide in the church. Stay in the church. Stay in the church. It's a demon that says stay at home on a Sunday morning. It is a devil. Why do I say it's a devil? Because that thing that says don't go out on a Sunday morning, don't go to church on a Sunday morning, by Monday that thing has gone. Then that thing says go to school, go to work. If it's just human beings, it's like human, just stay by yourself. It will keep you in bed on Monday. It will keep you in bed on Tuesday. It will keep you there because it wants you to be there. But it's not. It's about church. So those who are affected by those things, understand. Now that you are sober, understand. So when it happens, you will remember that, that thing is coming. It's coming. It's about to tell me that don't go to church. It's like her nose saying that I'm going off. No, I was screwed it back. I've tightened the screws. It's intact. Yes. Say that I'm going off. Where is it going? Where is it going? When any part of your body develops that disease, where it becomes independent, and then it begins to grow, do you know what it's called? It's called a cancer. When cells begin to multiply, they begins to expand. You see the breast. It says, you know what? I am growing. I'm growing. I don't care about the other part of the body. I am growing. I don't care about anything else. I am growing. I am becoming bigger. Or the brain decides that I am growing. Now it doesn't even fit inside the head. You're about to die. You're about to die. Because the brain says that I am growing, I am getting bigger, I'm going to be big. It's death. When you start cutting yourself off the church, you're killing yourself. You're killing yourself. You're separating yourself. That's what Jesus is saying, that when you abide, when you pray, I will answer. What else did I tell you? What other promise do you have? Say it like how I say it and you understand what I'm saying. God has promised to answer the prayers of those with persistence. Persistence. You know, persistent means keep trying. Keep trying. Don't give up. Never give up. Never give up. Persist. Persist. Stay with it. Don't give up. Don't change your mind. Don't resign. You've prayed once, twice. Don't say, I've prayed once, twice, so I don't think it will ever happen. It will happen.
Amen.
I said, it will happen.
Amen.
It will. It will happen.
Amen.
Don't give up. He will answer the prayer of the persistent. When you are persistent, God will come through.
Amen.
And there are some things that you need to persist in prayer. Yeah. Animals have different gestation periods. Some 3 months, some 3 weeks. Rats, I don't know how long rats are, but they multiply like rats. They just multiply. But human beings, elephants, I think elephants very long. 22 months for an elephant. That's like 2 years. Pregnant for 2 years. So you see, when it drops, you can see the size. Imagine if elephants give birth like rats. The whole earth will be full of elephants. That's why sometimes your big dreams, be patient with it. It's an elephant that is coming. It's an elephant. Don't be discouraged. It's an elephant that you're about to give birth to. It's an elephant. It's not a mouse. It's not a mouse. It was a mouse in some weeks. Rabbits, I think rabbits are very short. You see, like that, just they're just. Elephant, 22 months. That's 2 years. And you want it to happen like you're about to give birth to a rat? Be patient with your elephant dreams. Your elephant dreams shall come to pass.
Amen.
It will happen for you.
Amen.
Your big dreams, it shall happen.
Amen.
Be patient. Amen. Don't give up. Amen. Keep trying. Amen. Keep pressing. Amen. Keep pressing. That's what you have to understand yourself and know your calling and know your place. And don't compare yourself to others. You see, even in the university, there are different courses. Some courses demand more discipline and more focus than others. Your friends cannot easily be someone who has a lighter course. Do you understand? It's always better to make friends with people who are in the same shape as you. Because your friends affect you. Whether you like your friends affect you. When your friend is free and you're not free, you'll be forced to be free. You're forced to be free. So let's go here before you escape it. But you are not, what the elephant course that you have, you don't go skipping. They can afford to skip and then just bounce back. But you can't afford to skip around. But because you don't understand who you are, you see yourself skipping with everybody. Skipping around. You have to do so. You have to know in the ministry as well, in Christians, you have to know who you are. You have to know who you are. So you respect yourself. I was with some brothers the other day. I said, the only advice I can give you is that respect yourselves. Respect yourselves and respect the call of God on your life. That is how you will do well. If you have a call, if you don't have a calling, your problems are not real problems. But if you think God has called you, respect yourself and respect the call of God, because you are not the same as these people without callings. One of the ways you can see how someone is not called is how he conducts himself. Because if this guy is not called or he's not aware of his calling. That's why Jesus' advice. It's Jesus who said it, not me. It's Jesus. Should I tell you what he said? He said, cast not your pearls before swine, neither give that which is holy to dogs. I call it the swine test. If you want to know whether someone is a swine, give the person a precious thing, a valuable thing. Give the person a ministry, anointing. And see how he handles it. You see that you've discovered a pig. It's a swine test. Appoint a pig as an elder, you see. Because it's not for pigs. You see how they carry it, how they treat what they've had. It's like you are in an office to serve God. You are a priest. Then you behave as though you're a carpenter or a plumber or an electrician. As though you have nothing to do. It's like you said, you're not serious. Play any game, do anything. You do anything that your age group does. It's like then you convince yourself that everybody my age does it. No, I'm sorry. Everybody your age doesn't do it. There are some that have regard for their calling. Regard and respect for their calling. Anyway, before my topic changes, persist. Persist. And God will answer. What else did we talk about? That's it. Okay, so today I can give you a couple more, isn't it? Are you ready for a couple more? Oh, you're tired. You want to go home?
No!
Are you full already? You're full. The next promise is that God answers prayers of those with faith. Those with faith. Those who believe. When you're praying, believe. Believers are different from unbelievers. A believer is different from an unbeliever. Someone who believes in anything, he's different from someone who doesn't believe. Someone who believes that I have a calling is different from someone who doesn't think he has a calling. Sometimes there are people who don't think they have a calling, so we try to point out to them. That's one of the duties of a pastor. When he ascended up on high, he gave unto us apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the edifying of the church. For the edifying of the church. That is, edify is building. To build us up. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Edify, that's building the body of Christ. Perfecting means bringing on to maturity. So getting the saints to mature. So getting someone who has a calling to respect himself. Like I was telling my young friends, respect yourself. It's like act maturely. It's like mature. It's not like become anointed. Or it's like mature. Understand who you are. Stop being childish. Because you are being childish. Children play. It's children who play. It gets to a point, games stop. Games has to cease. About 10 years ago, someone asked me what I wanted for my birthday. And I said I wanted a toy car. I meant it, that's what I wanted. And I got it. Nice red sports car with a remote control. So when I'm bored, then I sit down on the floor in my bed. Put it there. Zoom, 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 zoom. Then I'll call my son, come and check, are the lights on? Say, yeah, the lights are on. They go, they hit the wall, that's okay. Turn it for me, turn. I played with it for about 2 weeks. I got bored. Because I'm not a child. I don't have time. I don't have time for it. If I had time, I'll play with it. I wish I had time. I'll actually go to the field where there's peace. I'll buy one for each member of the family. I said, let's go racing on the field. And I'm making noise with my mouth. I make myself happy. I've grown up. You grow up, you move away from toys. There's a certain country that is celebrating their 60th anniversary tomorrow. And a few hours ago, I was at their international airport. Do you understand international airport? Air France was on the tarmac. British Airways was on the tarmac. KLM was on the tarmac. TAP Portugal was on the tarmac. Who was there? Brussels. Brussels Airlines. And then South African Airways. They were all there. They were all packed there. International airport. Besides the smaller aircrafts, you know, that do the domestic flights. It was all there. The airport was full of passengers. Just a few hours ago, I was there. Tomorrow, they are 60 years old. Do you know what happened whilst I was there? There was power cut twice. Power cut. But I'm told... I'm told that tomorrow the budget for the celebration, for the 60th birthday celebration, is $20 million. That's what they are spending tomorrow. That's what they are going to spend tomorrow. They are flying in Darlene Check, Sinach, and some one other person, I don't know who she is, to come and sing. Is it this is just like a child leading. They play. Everything serious is overlooked. Everything serious is overlooked. It's like, let's play. It's time to play. Let's play. Let's wear our suits and play. The older you get, the more mature you become. Parties diminish in your life. Have you noticed? Even on your birthday, you see that the people that you go out with become fewer and fewer. Not because you are unfriendly.
You are preaching to go out.
So you see, when you are 23, 2 years after graduation, and you are still into my birthday tinny. Are they coming? Oh, they come. I want 60 people for my birthday tinny. 23 years. 2 years after graduation. Tinny. I want 60 people. I want 80 people. Only 10 people came. You are going for a splash. You are splashing. Anyway, give me Mark 11. Wow. Maturity, it goes with some things. It comes with some things. Comes with it. Your international airport, there's power cut. I was there for less than 2 hours. It's not like I was there for 70 hours. Less than 2 hours that I spent there. Twice. The whole place went dark. Everybody went, oh. Then after a while, then it comes on. They'll be there again. But tomorrow, 20 million US dollars. Yes, you see. They have a way of dressing. They wear cloth with big adipose tissues. You see them. They be playing their high life song. They'll say this is for the good old days. Then they'll call their partners. Come, let's dance. Come.
Good old days.
$20 million. Whilst they are dancing, they are greeting their friends. So they are not looking at them. $20 million. Children with toys. Children with toys. The games. So you see yourself too. with toys, with games. You know how unserious you are. You immediately know how unserious you are. As soon as you find yourself in the position of responsibility, and you see that you are into games, you are into lighter things, you see how unserious you are. You see that you are also a child. Forget about the international airport people and think about yourself. You discover that, I'm also such a terrible leader. I'm in leadership position, but I'm a child. I'm playing games. I play games. I'm into games. So you said we are talking about faith, you see. So you can't tell me how this, what I'm saying, is linked to it. Okay. Go to verse 20. In the morning as they passed by, they saw that the fig tree had dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursest is withered away. And Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Tell your neighbor, have faith in God. Then verse 23, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith, shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, When you pray, believe. Is that the next word? Believe that you receive them and you shall have them. When you pray, believe. Next time you are praying, believe. Next time you are praying, believe. When you believe, you shall receive them. You shall have them. You will have what you believe. Next time you are praying, believe. Have faith. You see, he was working with them. Before this, he was working with them. He was hungry. He went to the fig tree. There were no figs. Then he said to the fig tree, may no one ever eat from you again. The next time they were coming back, they looked at the fig tree. The fig tree had withered. That is, it's dried off. So the disciples are saying that the tree that you cursed, he didn't say to the tree, I curse you, fig tree. He didn't say, I curse. He just said, may no man ever eat from you again. The words that he spoke amounted to a curse. So the disciples are saying that you cursed the fig tree, so it has withered. Then his response to them was, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Then he began to teach them about prayer. Then he said, he's teaching them now that when you pray, believe. That's the next time you are praying, believe. Don't be sleepy. Don't just while away the time. Don't just while away the time. Next time you are praying, even if it's for 2 minutes or 6 hours, believe and you shall have them. And you shall have them. And you shall have them. And you shall have it. Add faith to what you are praying about and you shall have them. And you shall have them. And you shall have them. Next time you are praying for someone's salvation, believe you will see it happening practically. You see the person trotting back to God, coming back to God. You'll be surprised. Expect surprises. Amen. Expect God to give you some wonderful surprises. Amen. The things you have prayed for, expect that it will be delivered. Amen. It will be delivered. Amen. It will come back. Amen. It will. Amen. It will. When you pray, the next word is believe that you will receive and you shall have. When you pray, believe that you will receive and you will have. Expect answers to your prayer.
Amen.
Do you want the next promise? Are you tired?
No.
Is it time to go home?
No.
The next one is that God has promised to answer the prayer of humble people. Humble. Humble. Humble people. You need humility in prayer. You need to be humble at heart. You need to be a humble person. Humble person. It's a promise. Luke chapter 18. Verse 10. Two men went up into the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, the other a publican. Do you know a publican? Publicans are like, they collect taxes. They cheat. they are not exactly good people. You see, this particular passage is going to teach us how the things that perhaps you value are not that important to God. What is important to him are usually unseen qualities. Unseen. They are not things that you see with the eyes. You don't see it with the eyes. That's why one day Jesus was teaching his disciples and he said, bring that child. They brought a little child. He put a little child in front of them. And he said to them that these are the type of people that belong to the kingdom of God. People who see the kingdom of God, the power of the kingdom, the anointing, the blessings, the riches, the wealth. People who are children, when you're like a child, a cardinal sign of a humble person is childlikeness, not childish, childlike. To such belong the kingdom of God. A child. Someone you can talk to, someone you can advise, someone you can direct, someone you can correct. When you correct a child, what does the child do? The child cries for a while, but the child comes back to you. That's a child. It's so natural for a child to cry for a while and come back. When we start losing that quality, when we cry, then we leave. That is pride. That is pride. When you walk away, when you say, I've had enough. When you start talking, I've had enough. I can't take it. I don't want it. It's pride. You are proud. You may not know that you are proud, but you are proud. I can't take it. I don't want it. I'm leaving. It's embarrassing. Embarrassing. Have you seen a child embarrassed before? I went to visit someone who has given birth. Whilst we're sitting there. They've given me orange juice. We were sitting there. The child was there. The child just started making noises. And then the parents were feeling bad. But the boy was not feeling bad. He didn't even end there. He gave us extra. Then you know what happened next? The atmosphere. You feel the atmosphere. The child was okay. He was okay. The parents were feeling bad. The child was okay. To a child, a mistake is part of life. You don't argue. You don't fight. You don't blame on all this. You don't explain. I've made a mistake. Sorry, it's okay. We move on. To the proud, I've got to take a stance and defend myself and insist on my ways. That's why you can't take it. You can't be led. You can't be spoken to. You can't be counseled. It's pride. Why can't you be corrected? Are you an angel? Where's my passage? What have you done with it? The Pharisee stood. So I'm explaining to you who the publican is. So the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. God, I thank thee that I am not as other men. I am not as other men are. Extortioners. I'm sure he was thinking of the Pharisee. The publican. I'm sure he's saying, I'm not like these people. Unjust. Adulteress. You know, when you haven't had some problems before. Do you know usually your strongest point is the things you've never done. Not the things that the Bible says. The things you've never done. If I give you this microphone to preach, you see your greatest examples are areas where you are strong in. There are people when they are preaching, they'll never mention fornication. Because they know. You see, one day, a certain sister said, she said, I don't do people's husbands. That's how righteous she is. That's her righteousness. Do you understand? Or I have to explain it to you. She said, I don't do people's husbands. That's her righteousness. She's a super fornicator. But she's explaining that in my Super Bowl fornication championship. Listen. I don't do husbands. I don't do husbands. As soon as I detect that you are somebody's husband, you are off my list. But once you are free. So what she's saying is that the sin, what sin is to her, is to go and take someone's husband or abuse. That's sin. Anything else is not sin. So she said, she was proudly saying that I don't do other people's husbands. I can do all other males, but not husbands. So you discover your righteousness and what you feel strong about. It's not even on God's marking scheme. So he says, this guy, this Pharisee, a teacher of the law. Pharisee is a teacher of the master of the law. These are powerful guys, religious guys. Adulteress. So I'm not an adulterer. Or even as this publican. You are praying to God and you are pointing at someone. Can you imagine? We've all gone for an all night. That's what we are praying. That's what you're talking. Like, God, you know, I'm not even like alto. That's what he's doing. That's what he's doing. He's mentioning names in the church. As they are all praying, telling, Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. No, Lord, I pay my tithe. Lord, you know I'm always in church. Lord, you know I'm in film stars. Lord, even film stars, you know, I act decent. I'm not even like Alto, who dances anyhow. That's what he's saying. As they are praying, he's mentioning names and pointing at people in the church. But I said two men went to the temple. They were in church, and he's pointing as they are praying. He said, I am better than Otto. I am better than him. Better than him. Verse 12. I fast twice in the week. Hey! Then he said, and then what? And I give tithes of all that I possess. Hey, Mr. Perfect. And then the publican, standing afar off. You see, When you sit at the back in church sometimes, don't worry that you're sitting at the back. God can see you.
Amen.
God can see and God can hear your prayer. It means that the Pharisee was in front and the publican was at the back. And then, listen, the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes to heaven. The other guy was speaking, "Father, in the name of, you know, whoever, I am not even like Brother Otto in the church." It's like the righteous are as bold as lions. So I am speaking to God. This one. He said he can't even lift up his eyes. Can't even lift up. So he must have. God sees your posture in prayer. Sees how you are as you're in bed. He sees all. You see so. Because the same hour that you're talking to God with your sleep breath. That same hour. If your boy calls you, you will sit up and change your voice. Even if he detects that you are sleeping, he says that, "Oh, you are sleeping." So you say, no, I'm okay. No, I'm okay. No, I'm okay. No, I'm okay. No. It's okay. I know what I'm saying. I know people who, beloved, those in different time zones, they'll stay up for a phone call, they'll stay up into the wee hours of the morning, just chatting about nothing. When it gets to prayer, when it gets to God. I'm only explaining to you that God sees all these, he sees all these things. He sees all. Tell their parents that they are going to study. They are going to sit somewhere. In the library, they don't even open the book once. They are on the phone with a boy. It's like, I have to entertain him. FaceTime, he has to see me. Your lips are like traffic lights at 3 a.m. Rather, he smote upon his breasts. It's like that. As he's praying, it's like that. You know, he's not lifting up his eyes. It's like, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." Do you realize that when Jesus taught us how to pray, one of the things he put there is that you ask God for forgiveness of sins. That God forgive me of my sins. It's pride to think you have no sin. It's pride to think that you have made no mistake. You are not wrong. It's pride. It's pride to think that you are not wrong. When wrong is pointed out, you don't even have to. You have to say, "Perhaps I don't understand. Perhaps there's something I can't see." It's pride to think that you're okay. It's pride. Any discussion that you have with people you are leading, like your children, that lasts longer than 5 minutes, means you are dealing with a proud person. Either that child is proud or that person that you are leading is a proud person. 5 minute discussion, five. You've met a proud person. Talk, you talk back. Humility is coming upon you. It's not intelligence. It's not that you're intelligent. Some of us think that is a sign of intelligence. When you can argue, or you can have your case, or you can make a case and make a point and, you know, stand by, stand on your point and stay with your point. They feel like, you know, it's like, why can't I? Of course, you can express yourself. But don't express yourself to a point where you become a fool. That's what I'm trying to save you from. Of course, you can express. Of course, you can say your mind. Say your mind. But what mind are you saying? What mind is there that you are putting out? That's all I'm also saying. That what mind is it that you are putting out there? So that you have to give credit to some people. Now, this person must know something that I don't know. Don't argue over everything. Give your parents some credit. They know something you don't know. If nothing at all, they know the day you were born. You don't know that day. You don't know what that day looks like. Abba. Verse 14. Look, let's close and go home. He said, I tell you, this is Jesus speaking. He said, I tell you. Can you hear someone talking and tell you that? I tell you. I mean, it's like he's telling you a story. He's recounting an incident. He says, I tell you that day. He said, I tell you, this man went down to his house, justifies rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. May you be exalted.
Amen.
Learn humility. Practice humility. Pray for a humble spirit. Pray for not an arguing spirit, a spirit that argues. You argue. You always have an argument. Argue with your father, argue with your mother, argue with your lecturers, argue with your pastors, argue with your elder. You argue anybody that comes across you. The person is met with argument. It's like you are into debates. Argue. Then you say, you know, everything is not just, it's not everything is not linear. There are some complex issues. So there are some things that you can look at it from three different angles. Number one, this. Number two, this. Now, you see, usually when you see people, you just ask them their age. They are around about 18 or 19. They're young. As you grow up, you tick off some of the options. So when you cross a certain age and you haven't ticked off some of the options, it means that you're not intelligent. That you don't learn. You're not learning. That's why you've grown up to that age and you are still, you argue with authority. You see, the person has power and you are fighting with power. You don't fight with power. You don't fight with power. You don't fight. Power will destroy you. Yeah. You don't fight against power. You don't do that. And then when they want to control you, she's when they get to a certain point, you see some of the sisters went on to control. They use tears for their argument. Yeah. That is the controlling spirit. They use tears. They begin to cry. Every issue that you bring up for discussion, then she starts crying. It means I'm hurting. I mean, you're causing me so much distress. I'm in pain. This thing is really, stressing me out. So it's like you have to back off. No, that's witchcraft. That's witchcraft. When you marry, come and see me. I'll give you an advice. You have to learn how to talk through tears. She's crying, but you are talking. When she finishes, you just take your tissue and say, It's okay. Don't cry anymore. I still love you. Yeah. Tears. They use tears. Tears on my pillow. Pain in my heart. We're all talking. We're all reasoning through an issue. The next week, you see tears are flowing. It's like I'm hurting you, so I should back off. It is witchcraft is not Halloween when we are flying. No. I'm serious. Witchcraft, listen. Witchcraft is in Galatians chapter 5. It's one of the works of the flesh. It's witchcraft, works of the flesh. It means a controlling force, a controlling power. Someone who controls you. Witchcraft, there. One of the works, it's one of the works of the flesh. Is it the same category as hatred and strife? They belong to the same group, witchcraft. When someone tries to control you. When God was calling Ezekiel, he was calling Jeremiah, surprisingly, he said, don't be afraid of their faces. Not their weapons, not their guns. He said their faces. Because when you go to church, people can use their face to control you. It's like, we are tired. We've had enough. We don't like what you are saying. He said, don't be afraid of their faces. It's witchcraft. When you try to control someone with moods. Moods. I knew a brother once. He's a pastor now. He used to have a lot of moods. He was like a bag of moods. When we have a meeting, he's sitting there, you see, grumpy. Hey, one day I was talking in the meeting, he slept. He lay in the sofa and slept. I said, don't wake him up. When we finish the meeting, I have a meeting with him. He will not sleep again. He has not slept again. Now, when I stand up and I'm preaching, you see, he smiles a lot. As I'm speaking, he's even smiling now. He smiles. Now, he smiles a lot. He's a pastor now. Did I tell you he's a pastor now? Yes, now he's a pastor. He's sitting here. Not a lady pastor. A male pastor. A male. But you hardly ever come by a moody guy. Guys are not usually moody. Yeah. So this one, as soon as you see, when you see a moody guy, you know that you've seen a certain type of person. Guys, we usually don't care about a lot of things. I mean, a lot of things don't bother us. When you see us and you walk past us, we just look at you and say, we just probably he has flu or something. I mean, there's a problem. We don't know. That's a guy. Next time we see you, we'll not say, yes, like the other day you saw me, you didn't talk to me. No. We'll just say, hey, Charlie, how? But a girl, when you walk past a girl, hey, is the mother of all wars. No. But guys, we are not like that. So you see a moody guy, it's a special case. It's a special case. How can you be a man and be moody? Where did you get that from? What tablet did your mother give you? Oh. I need to give you to a Nigerian mother for 3 months. It will all be stripped off. She'll look at you and say, idiot. Haven't you seen a Nigerian mom on the bus before with the children? Even if they use one stop, I mean, the children will get at least 6 idiots. Three children, there'll be 6 idiots and 7 stupid before they get off the bus. And when they are getting off the bus, they have a way of pushing you off here. See, the child looks confused. Have you seen those children who trot behind their parents? Yeah, as they are walking on the pavement, you see the child is trotting.
Try to catch up.
Yeah. I see humility coming upon you.
Amen.
Stand to your feet. Sondalebe, Dibakaba, Labadoba, Libadaba, Shadata, 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 Shadata Labradiste, Yabrakisto. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you. We thank you this afternoon. Thank you for your blessing. Thank you for the blessing of your word. Thank you for faith, Lord. Thank you for humility, O God. Thank you for strength and grace to abide in you and to stay in you, Lord. And to stay in the body, in the church that you have given to us, Lord. Thank you for that grace, Lord. We banish every attempt of the enemy to affect our faith, to affect our trust in you and our confidence in you, Lord. We curse those efforts, Lord. We curse those works, oh God. We curse the works of backsliding. We curse the works of confusion, Lord. We curse all such works, Lord, that takes away precious souls and causes precious souls to drift away, Lord. May the devil be cursed, Lord. May his efforts be cursed from amongst us, Lord. May he never be able to steal our faith, Lord. May we survive till the end and say we have fought the good fight of faith, Lord. We have fought the good fight of faith, Lord. May we believe to the end. May we believe to the end, Lord. Father, grant us that spirit of humility. That spirit of humility. To see truth. To accept truth. To see instructions. To accept instructions. To see your word. And to accept your word, oh God. Give us that character. That we shall be called humble. That you will look upon us and say, this one is humble, Lord. This one is humble. Thank you, Lord, that you may exalt us and promote us and bless us. Thank you for the blessing of your word today. And thank you for the healing of our hearts and the healing of our ways today. In the name of Jesus, oh God. Now, while every eye is closed and every head is bowed, I want to pray for you. You are here, someone invited you to church. You are here for the first time. You've been coming to church. But deep in your heart, you know you have no relationship with God. Now this afternoon, while every eye is closed and every head is bowed, you want to say that, Pastor, pray with me. I want to have a relationship with God. I want to be saved. I want to be born again. I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. Pastor, please pray with me. I need Jesus in my life. I need eternal life. If you're here like that, you want to say, Pastor, pray with me. While every eye is closed and every head is bowed, say, Pastor, pray with me. I want to give my life to Jesus today. If you're here like that, I want you to just lift up your right hand wherever you are, and I'll pray with you. Very quickly, just your right hand. Lift up your right hand very quickly, and I'll pray with you. God bless you. I can see the hand there. God bless you. You also want to join in. While every eye is closed, it's a very serious time. You are choosing heaven over hell, life over death. Salvation over worldliness. You want to say, Pastor, pray with me. I need Jesus. I want Jesus in my heart. I want to live a better life and a godly life. Just your right hand and I'll pray with you. Just your right hand and I'll pray with you. God bless you. God bless you. If you have your hand lifted up, I want to do one more thing very quickly. One more thing. I want to come out of your seat and come to me right here in the front. Just come. You lift up your right hand. Come. Come to me. Maybe you didn't lift up your hand and you want to come. You can still come. You can still come. You didn't lift up your hand, but you want to come. You didn't think that we'll come to the front to be prayed for. You can still come. You can still come. Come quickly. If you want to come, come quickly. Come quickly. Let's pray very quickly. Thank you, Father. Oh, Lamb of God. Yes. Yes. Sing it again, just as I am. I'm waiting for you. You want to give your life to Jesus today. Jesus is calling you. Just come. Come to the love of God. Come to the love of God. Yes. Yes, Lord. it to him. Yes. Thank you. Close your eyes. Let's pray. Everybody here, bow your head. Let's pray together. Say with me, especially those of you in front. Say with me. The whole church, help us as we pray. Say, Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and rose up on the third day. Say, Heavenly Father, please forgive me of all my sins. I am a sinner. I am a sinner. Please forgive me. Wash me with the blood of Jesus. From today, please help me not to sin again. Please help me not to go back to my sins. Please help me to live for you. Say, thank you, Father, for Jesus Christ. Say, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, please come into my heart. Be the Lord of my life. Say, from today, I am your child. I shall live for you and I will obey you. Say, Heavenly Father, please write my name in the book of life. Say, thank you, Lord, for accepting me today. Making me a child of yours. In Jesus' name. Amen. Father, I pray for these three precious souls that you have redeemed today by the precious blood of Jesus and by your mercies, Lord. Oh God, have mercy on them. Bless them. Help them. Make them strong, Lord. Make them strong in you, Lord. Strengthen them, Lord. Let them find joy in you. Joy in your house. Let them find peace. Give her peace, Lord. Give her peace. Thank you, Lord, for salvation and for your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. We have some gifts for you. God bless you. God bless you. What's your name? Mariama. God bless you, Mariama. And your name is?
Bradley.
Bradley. Wow, God bless you. I like your hair, your beard. I just shaved off my beard. You came too late. You would have had a competition. Mine was salt and pepper. Yours is just black pepper. Yeah. Your name is? Elia. It's a beautiful name. God bless you. Serve God. He will help you to serve him, okay? In difficult times, he's not a wicked God. He's a kind God. So difficult times, just know that you are with a kind God. So don't judge yourself. Lean on his mercies. He's very forgiving. Very, very forgiving. Just don't take him for granted. But he's forgiven. So don't let anything tell you that I don't belong to God. You belong to him. That's where you belong. You're a child of God. Okay, so stay with God. And this is your church. I'm your pastor. From today, I've become your pastor. Yes. We'll look after you. My name is Richard. Did you know my name before? You didn't, yes. It's Richard. So when you see me at the bus stop, say, hi, Rich. Yes. So nice meeting you all. God bless you. Thank you for coming to church. God bless you. And live for God. Clap for them. You are entering into miracle time.
Amen.
Something's about to change in your life.
Amen.
Something that has not given up for a long time is about to give up today.
Amen.
Something that needs to be broken, that is not breaking, it shall be broken this afternoon.
Amen.
It shall be broken this afternoon.
Amen.
It shall be broken this afternoon.
Amen.
An addiction shall be broken.
Amen.
A curse shall be broken.
Amen.
A negative lifestyle shall be broken.
Amen.
Everything that impedes on your progress in Christ shall give up this afternoon.
Amen.
You shall leave this place lighter.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Just pray for yourself for 2 minutes. And then we'll just receive the communion. Pray for yourself. Commit yourself to the hands of God. Pray about something in particular. Because that thing shall dissolve today.
Amen.
That thing shall evaporate today. that problem shall go. Pray about it right now. You just have 120 seconds to pray. Just pray very quickly. Pray about it right now. Right now. Right now.
Arise and shine.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. It's giving up. It's going. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes. It's changing. It's changing. It's changing. It's changing. In this short while, it's changing. 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 It's changing permanently. It's a permanent change. It's a permanent change. Your liberation shall be permanent.
It shall come to pass.
It shall be permanent. It shall be permanent. No sickness shall return. No devil shall return. It goes and it goes permanently. Kapatota yabrakasta tire. Kredish tokaya. Kredish tokaya. Kredish tokaya. Kredish tokaya. It loses its hold on you. It loses its influence on you. It loses its power on you. It loses its works on you. It loses its influence on you. You are set free. You are liberated. You are liberated. Elevation comes on you. Promotion comes into your life. Increase comes into your life. You shall do well. You shall be free from every struggle. The battle is brought to an end. The battle is brought to an end. The battle is brought to an end. And you are declared victorious by the blood of Jesus. By the mighty name of Jesus, I declare you victorious this afternoon. Mahabra di Mashtea, Nazi Nota, Nazi Meke, Nazi Mika, Malibredo Shteata. Thank you. 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 You won. You won. Father, we thank you. We thank you for victory that has just been recorded in our lives, Lord. Every prayer that your children, Lord, have offered unto you today, every supplication, every concern, whatever has disturbed your children, Lord, thank you that from this very hour it shall no longer disturb them. Thank you, Lord, that from this very moment it shall no longer haunt them. Thank you, Lord, that from this very hour they shall not see the shadow of the presence of evil again. In the mighty name of Jesus, thank you for healing. Thank you for healing. Thank you that kidney is healed. Thank you, Father, for healing of that kidney. Thank you for healing for that kidney. That kidney is healed. Thank you that brain is healed, oh God. It's healed of tumor. It's healed of any disturbance, any condition, Lord. Thank you for healing, Lord. Thank you for your power. Your power that sets us free. Your power that sets us free. Your power that liberates us this afternoon. Thank you for your mighty power. We believe it and we receive it. We believe that we receive it. Every burden is broken. Every burden is lifted up, Lord. It's lifted off, Lord. It's lifted off, Lord. The spirit of heaviness goes this afternoon. It goes this afternoon. Depression goes this afternoon. Confusion goes this afternoon. Low moods goes this afternoon. Confusion. Religious confusion. I curse that spirit. Thank you, Father, for sanity, for peace, for clarity of mind, Lord. Thank you for loving us. 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 Thank you for your love, God. Thank you for your love. Thank you that you loved us and you gave us your only begotten Son, that when we believe in him, we should not perish but have everlasting life. Thank you for everlasting life. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for Jesus. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for that bright morning star that you gave to us, Lord. We thank you for Jesus. It's in him that we live, we move, and we have our being. It's in him that we have our healing. It's in him that we have our strength. It's in him that we have our deliverance. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that the name of Jesus rules and reigns in our lives and every aspect of our lives, Lord. Reign in us, Lord. Rule, Lord. Rule, Lord. Rule in us, Lord. Thank you for your blessing and thank you for your help. Thank you for all the healings that have taken place this afternoon. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, I speak a blessing, Lord, and sanctification over every wine and every bread, Lord. And I declare, Lord, as we eat it and drink it, it is your body and it is your blood, Lord. Let strength come into our lives. Let strength come into our bodies, Lord. For your word declares that he that eateth my flesh dwelleth in me and I in him, Lord. Come into us, Lord, and put us in you, Lord. Thank you for that blessing. Thank you for that blessing. And for thank you for that place. Thank that we are blessed as we eat. That we are blessed as we drink. In Jesus' name. Amen. The body of Christ, the body of Jesus Christ, eat it. This is the cup of blessing. You are drinking blessings into your life. You are drinking victory into your life. You are registering supernatural intervention. God will intervene in your life. It is going to be by God. Don't think, how is it going to happen? It shall be by God. Amen. It shall be by God. Amen. It shall be done by God. Amen. He will intervene. Amen. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus Christ. Drink all of it. On that hill far away.
On a hill far away.
Yes.
Stood an old,
yes,
rugged cross.
Sing it.
The emblem of suffering and shame.
Yes.
And I love.
Several healings have taken place this afternoon. Deliverance. Broken yokes. Destroyed yokes. Curses are destroyed. Oh, yes.
Sinners,
yes. Was
led.
Yes. Yes.
So I'll change.
I will. I will. I will.
The old rugged,
yes,
cross.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Till my trophy.
Yes, at last.
At last I lay.
I'm clinging to that cross.
I will cling,
yes,
to the old rugged cross.
It's the power of salvation. It's the power of salvation.
And exchange,
yes,
it someday for a crown.
Father, as we celebrate victory on that cross today, as we reenact, Lord, and live your death on the cross for us, Lord. Let victory be established in the lives of your people. Let victory come in their finances. Let victory come in their health. Let victory come in their relationships. Let victory come in their walk with you, Lord. In their walk with you, let there be victory, Lord. May they advance from victory to victory, Lord. Not from victory to defeat, Lord, but victory to victory, Lord. May the victories increase in their lives. May the victories increase in their lives. For every encounter that they go through, may they come out victorious, Lord. Give them victory, oh God. Every battle that they are currently in, Lord, give them victory, oh God. Thank you, Father, that today we are going home with the two words in our minds. We won. We won. We won. Thank you, Lord, for that victory. Thank you for that victory. In Jesus' name.